Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's Weekly Worship Podcast. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following traditional worship service was recorded on Sunday, January 15th, 2017, at our 9 o'clock service. The sermon was delivered by Pastor Bill Pavuk. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
To allow us this time to worship together safely, and a special welcome to all of these gray shirts, all of these bright-eyed and rested young people who were with us this weekend for our middle school gathering. Our theme, Matthew 25:35, for I was hungry and you gave me... For I was thirsty and you gave me. I was a stranger and you. Our theme focusing on hunger, what we do about hunger as a church, what we do about hunger in our communities, and some wonderful eye-opening activities for our youth, great music and worship leadership. From Matt and Simone Weber, Table Grace Cafe, and great leadership from our young adult resource persons, our YARPs from the Synod, and from Lisa Cramey and her entire planning team. We thank them for the great experience that they put together, and the many who were participating. Many of the congregations that were here for the event left last night or this morning because they're quite some miles away, and their weather circumstances may be very different from those here. But all of us left, all of them left not only recharged and inspired, but they also left with a mission to pay it forward and to invite their congregations into that mission. And I know the young people that were participating from St. Paul's were looking forward to introducing that and sharing more about that with the congregation in the weeks to come. A couple of other reminders, our Come Grow With Us classes begin today. Is that correct? I'm sorry?
Because of weather.
I'm sorry?
We are postponing it because of the weather this afternoon.
Thank you.
The week after the Super Bowl, February 11th, will be the first session.
February 11th, we'll be moving the Come Grow With Us classes too. Thank you, Pastor Ed. Our annual reports are available in the lobby, and there's a sample ballot for our elections in the reports. Nominee profiles with photos will be ready this coming week. And also during our worship service today, we will be recognizing and celebrating any of our third graders that are here, both at this service and also at the 11 o'clock service. Any of our third graders will be welcome to come forward and recognized, and we'll be sharing in that milestone of presenting them with the Word of God in the form of their own Bibles. I invite you to keep in your prayers those hospitalized this past week, including Mary Ann Nelson, David Wood, and Jan Meyer. And with that, I invite you to turn in your bulletin to our order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nations, who gives breath to us all. Amen. Now let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. You may kneel or sit. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all when we have hurt others, those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around, give us a fresh start, so that we can live again as your children. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Stand for our gathering song. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, for this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Thank you. save, comfort and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, our strength and our Redeemer, by your Spirit hold us forever, that through your grace we may worship you and faithfully serve you, follow you, and joyfully find you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Congregation may be seated.
Keep your love.
this time, do we have third graders here? Do we have any third graders here? Third graders and parents, please come forward at this time. Milestones Ministries are part of the partnership between our congregation and our families in sustaining and nurturing the gift and promises of baptism. And I will start by handing the Bibles from the church to the parents. And then in a minute here, the transition, the next step in that transition will complete the process. Today you're given something that is intended to be opened and used. There's plastic on them right now. I hope the plastic is off before Al or Ed finishes the first reading. Okay? Need you to rip into it fast. All right? It's something that as you read it, it's supposed to make you ask questions. So when you have questions, that's okay. That's a good thing. It's something that's there to inspire you to love and to bring you comfort. It's something that one pastor once called a love letter from a lovesick God. And it guides us and it instructs us for life. Congregation, join me in sharing with them what else this is. God's word is a light to our path. It is the cradle that holds the truth and heart of Christ for us. As I said before, this recognition is about keeping promises, the promises of baptism, by bringing your children to learn about the faith and to receive and know God's word, which includes the scriptures. I'd like to ask that each parent give the Bible to their child and say the inspired word of God, and for the children to respond, thank you for keeping your promise. The inspired word of God, thank you for keeping your promise.
Let us pray. Dear God, bless these children, their families, friends, and teachers, with the joy of learning about your love for them and your will for their lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Turn to your seats and rip that plastic off.
First reading for our consideration this morning comes from the book of Isaiah, verse 49. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified. But I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with God. And now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the sight of the Lord. And my God has become my strength. He says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and his Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, the slave of rulers. Kings shall see and stand up, princes, and they shall prostrate themselves because of the Lord, who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand for our gospel acclamation. Holy Gospel according to St. John in the first chapter. The next day, John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they began to follow Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" Jesus said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Congregation may be seated. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Story today about looking and seeking, searching. There's this old fable about the theme of looking and searching for things that I love. It's about a guy that was looking for a lost wristwatch, and he's rummaging through the drawers in the desk of his family room. And his wife came in. His wife came in, and she asked the question that has been asked of everyone who has ever lost anything in the history of time, which is, "Where did you lose it? Where did you have it last? Where'd you leave it? Where did you last see it?" Something along those lines. To which the answer is usually, "I don't remember." Because if we knew where it was, we'd look there, obviously. But in this parable, the man turns to his wife and says, "I last saw it in the basement." So his wife naturally says, "Yeah, why aren't you looking for it in the basement?" And the man said, "Well, it's a lot lighter and it's easier to look for it here." Moral of the story being sometimes even when we know what we're looking for, even when we're fairly sure about where to look, sometimes we'd rather look where it's easiest than where we're going to find it. It's also a story about how it matters to know what we're looking for. It matters to know what we're looking for. It matters to know where we're seeking. In the gospel text for today, Jesus asks John's disciples a question that is both very simple and very complicated at the same time. And it's a great question for all of us, too. It's a great question. It's a great question, really, at any time in our lives, a question that we probably don't ask enough of ourselves and one another. Certainly a good question at the beginning of a year, as we're still fairly early in 2017. What are you looking for? Now, like I said, on the surface, it sounds pretty simple. I'd imagine the disciples say, Rabbi, and meaning teacher. And in a sense, they may have wanted to say, we're looking for you. We're looking for the Messiah. We're looking for the Lamb of God. John said, you're really great, really special, really important, really holy. We're looking for that. But that's not entirely what Jesus is asking. He's asking for what they're looking for beyond that, beyond those things. He's asking them, are you looking for comfort? Or are you looking for a path to being comfortable? He's asking them, are you looking to learn how to love? Or are you looking to learn how to be liked? He's asking if they're looking for a warrior or a servant. He's asking if they're looking for someone who shows them that they've finally arrived, or if they're looking for someone who is ready to take them on a journey. So it's a simple question, but it's not a simple question. There's a direct answer that we all share, but there's also a number of answers that apply to millions of different situations depending on where we're at in our lives. And so for us too, it's a meaningful question. And it's a simple question, and it's a complicated question. What are you looking for? What are you looking for in the Christ? What are you looking for in Christ's church? What are you looking for in the world around you? Because what we're looking for matters. What we're looking for, where we're looking, has a lot to do with what we're going to find and how we're going to progress, what we're becoming in Christ. So what are you looking for? Let's start with the simple, the simpler, more common, basic answers. We're looking to worship, obviously. We're looking to be fed. We're looking to give honor and praise to God. We're here to get that dose of grace and wisdom and truth and encouragement. We're looking to get that inoculation from God as we go out to face our week. But beyond that, the answers to what we're looking for can be very different from one person to the next. And they matter for the Christ partly because what we're looking for in Jesus, in the church, in a faith community, tends to influence what we will find there. And it's not that what we're looking for is always exactly what is immediately going to happen, but it does seem to influence what we see and what we find. If we're coming to Christ to find answers, we may just find them, some of them. But just as with those who would follow him in today's gospel, what we tend to find from Jesus when we come for answers is also more questions. More questions to struggle with. More questions to move us in a different direction, to orient us to thinking in a different way. But while answers are not always immediate from God, when we do come to Christ, what we find is community. We find community. We find the support and the presence of the Spirit to sustain us, even if the answers aren't immediately there. And we find these lives. We find these lives sitting around us, people that we're brought nearer to, lives that are full of stories that while we're searching for answers, the wisdom in those stories, in those lives, brings us sometimes what we need while we're looking for what we want. If we're coming to the church looking for law, for order, for structure, well, you may find that as well. Although we don't really need Christ to find those things for us. Instead, what we find in Christ is a freedom, a shelter, a transcending of those things that Christ has come to bring us. If you're looking to the Christ for shelter and safety, Christ's life, we find that his life was poured out to bring those things to us. But if you come seeking those things, you're also likely to be somebody who perceives where those things are lacking, who notices those needs, who notices those hungers in those around us. If you're looking to Christ to allow you to see the world differently, to give you different eyes and perspective, you're likely to find that too. For our confirmands, middle schoolers who are here this weekend, it's an excellent question. It's a great question about the middle school gathering. It's a pretty good question about confirmation, too. What are you looking for? Way over 100 kids came this weekend, and I'm sure there's a lot of different answers to that question. Maybe family expectations, maybe about a friendship, maybe just about, getting some time to enjoy peers. And a lot of other things. But what you find here, what you found here this weekend was an invitation to pay it forward. What you found here this weekend was a new awareness about the needs of the lives of those around us, of the needs of the world, and about how the church is standing up and meeting those needs, and about how you are a part of that, how all of us get to share in that journey, in that adventure together with one another. Christ's message coming to life, whether you were looking for it or not, that was here for us. What we're looking for has a lot to do with what we see and what we take away, just like with what we're looking for in the world. If we approach others looking for the ways that they're different, if we approach others looking for the ways that we can disagree with them, oh, we're going to find reasons to disagree, aren't we? If we approach our spouses or our children or our parents or our siblings looking for faults so that we can criticize, we're going to find them. And if they look at us for those things, they're going to find those things in us too. Oh boy, they're going to find those things in us. But if we approach others looking for things to appreciate, things that we share with them, we will find those things. If we approach those we love looking for reasons to celebrate them, looking for things to praise, looking for things that we enjoy, looking for things that we admire. If we approach those we love looking for things that inspire us in them, we will find those things too. And maybe they'll even find them in us. So what we're looking for does matter. But through Christ's love for us, God always has more in store for us than whatever we might be looking for at first. Just as those first disciples could only imagine what they were becoming a part of. I'm sure when they looked at Jesus and said, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" I'm sure there must have been a part of Jesus that said, "Oh, you have no idea. But you will. Come and see." And it's the same for us. Just as those first disciples could only imagine all that they were becoming a part of, it's the same for us. Even for those who first come to Christ looking for status or looking for a place to hide or looking to impress someone else or just to satisfy someone else's expectation. Even for them, the font and the table and the body that they find meeting them here doesn't allow us to stop with those things, doesn't leave us in that place. Christ cares what we're looking for, but he's not at all going to be bound by it. I remember when I was in seminary, I heard stories of pastors who had gone through seminary in years past, specifically clergy that went through the seminary in the 1960s and the 1970s. How a lot of them chose that path for a lot of different reasons, looking for a lot of different things. But that a lot of them, and a lot of pastors in those times, looked to the church in large part as an escape from going to war. Most of them had strong belief, raised in the church, though I also heard stories of a few of them that really weren't sure where they stood with God in the beginning. But while they first looked to Christ's church as little more than an escape, I heard about how their lives at that time continued in ministry, continued doing incredible work for Christ's church. Because what Christ has for us is bigger than whatever we might be looking for. Whatever might have brought us through the door, got us to Bible study, got us to Sunday school. By his grace, we move so much further than those things to be different, because we can know and understand who we are and whose we are and what we're here about like never before. When we come and see what God is doing, even when we really have no idea how much and how great a thing we're getting ourselves into. No matter what it is that we're looking for, new life will happen. Peace be with you. Amen. Invite the congregation to stand as we join in singing.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Called to be a light to the nations, let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing grace. Holy Lord, you alone are God. You are one and you call us to be one. Remove jealousy and quarreling between Christian denominations and within Christian denominations. Hold us in the unity of our baptism as we work together to serve you. May we grow in oneness with each other and in you. Lord, in your mercy. You called into being the very first fruits of the earth, and you gave fruits enough to feed the world. Use us as your hands to feed the world. Guide gardeners and farmers as well who till the soil and tend the fields. Bless all work in due season, bring forth the bounty of the land. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, your love knows no bounds. Break down the barriers caused by nationalism, competing ideologies, a political rancor. Challenge the stereotypes we cling to. Give us courage to engage in difficult conversations with those whose experiences and perspectives are different from our own. Lord, in your mercy, pour out your Holy Spirit on all who struggle with the burden of sickness, the pain of divorce, the shadow of death. We pray especially for those we hold in our hearts, and we name them before you. Lord, in your mercy, you know every hair on our heads, and yet we do not even know each of our neighbors. Equip our outreach ministry and this assembly to get to know the people in our community, to share the story of your love. Lord, in your mercy, we ask your blessing on the middle schoolers who have been a part of our great gathering. You have fed their hunger to know you and your love. Use them to lead us in sharing your food, both spiritual and earthly foods, for our welfare with all people. Be with them in their travels and keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal Lord, you are the God of our ancestors in faith. You are our God. Keep us faithful until we join all the saints at your heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. peace of the Lord be with you always. Also with you. We share this gift of peace.
Invite all to stand as we prepare for the meal. We pray together. Merciful God, receive the gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all of the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. You sent a star to guide wise men to where the Christ was born, and your signs and witnesses in every age and through all the world have led your people from far places to his light. In his baptism and in table fellowship, he took his place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death. And you made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours. Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. We join together with those around us as a family of faith as we pray in the words that our Savior taught. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Congregation may be seated. We who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Come and be filled with light and life. The feast is now ready. Christ himself, the host, all are welcome. Please stand. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We pray together. O morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, every day, and we tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praise both now and forever. Amen. May the God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Join our closing song.
Peace and be the light of Christ to the world. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for worshiping with us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.